YouTube. It is the 17th of March at 10:45 in the morning, 2017. And you're watching podcast number 9, which is titled Hermetic Kabbalah, Part 4, Ruach. So before I get started, I have to apologise for taking so long to get this podcast out. I'm in the Southern Hemisphere and we're just moving now from summer into autumn, which means that in the background the audio here has been picking up a lot of cicada noise. After I did the last bit of videoing, my attempt at trying to get this 9th podcast out, when I played it back, the cicada chirping was so loud that it was extremely annoying to watch. I also usually video by natural light, and we've had about 2 weeks of rain here and it's been overcast nearly all of the time. On the days where it hasn't been overcast and it's been sunny, all the cicadas have been out, but today it's supposed to be sunny all day, so the light is good, hopefully, and the cicada sound, even though there's still a bit in the background, hopefully it's not as bad as it was. So let's begin, first of all, by very quickly going over what I've talked about up to this point. So we're talking about the Partsuthim, which is one of the subjects associated with Kabbalah. And the Partsuthim, there are six of them, six primary Partsuthim. They are archetypes or intelligences which make up the human psyche and exists at the very root of what our mind as human beings is. So because Kabbalah and esoteric knowledge in general revolves around the nature of human psychology and how it can be exploited in order to achieve various effects. Kabbalah, of course, there is a very deep interest in esoteric psychology. So this is one of the reasons why I'm starting off talking about Partsuthim theory at the beginning of these podcasts. So the first one of the Partsuthim we looked at is the one lowest on the ladder, and that is Nakash, or the serpent or dragon, which represents the very foundation of human psychology. So Nakash is like the clay of the human mind, in which, from which the vase of the human mind is constructed. So Nakash is the most ancient ground bed of human psychology, and eventually out of the Nakash grew Nefesh. The word Nefesh translates from Hebrew into English as animal soul. But in the terms of modern psychology, Nefesh is the unconscious mind, not the subconscious mind, which is what virtually everybody has got into the habit of saying. The subconscious is something completely different. Nefesh is the unconscious mind, because everything that is inside of her, we are unconscious of. She is a receptacle and she contains everything that makes up the human mind, human psychology, the human psyche. The primary dynamic of the human psyche is a binary relationship between two poles. Eventually, another function of mind grew out of the unconscious, out of the Nefesh, and that is the Ruach, which is the subject of today's podcast. And Ruach is the male pole of that binary relationship. So Nakash, the serpent, is the force, or the computer code, the software, if you like, of the mind that created division in the human psyche, which gave rise to the human psyche. Nakash is the separator or the divider, the thing that maintains division. What is divided is unity, a state of unity consciousness, the higher self. As soon as that divides, it separates into two poles of mind, a male and a female pole. And in the temporal universe, in temporal reality, the two poles of the human psyche are the Nefesh and the Ruach. So Nakash, Nefesh, and Ruach are the three facets of the incarnate human personality. Everything you are in your mind, almost without exception, everything you are as an incarnate human being in your mind has its root in Nakash, Nefesh, Ruach, and how those three facets of the mind relate to each other. So a little bit of history about how all this unfolds. It is my personal belief, my understanding, my educated guess, that Nefesh ruled the human mind before the first Homo sapiens arrived on the planet 50,000 years ago. Before the first Homo sapiens arrived on the planet, evolved, or what, however they came about, whatever the human genome was incarnate as, for example, Neanderthal man, they lived primarily from a Nefesh form of consciousness, which gave them a mother goddess kind of a view of the world, because the Nefesh, as the anima mundi, is the consciousness or the mind of the planet. And it's a collective social consciousness, it's animal consciousness, and it lacks self-awareness and reasoning. But it is immersed deeply in nature and is aware intimately of all of the forces of nature that are responsible for all of the manifest aspects of the world we see around us: trees, water, air, sky, and all of those things. And I think personally that the essential concept about the Homo sapien is that he represented the first development of the Ruach, or the conscious mind. And this is the thing that made Homo sapiens distinctive from the previous primates, the ones who had existed before Homo sapiens arose. So that's the macrocosmic view of the relationship between Nefesh and Ruach, that it exists on a collective scale for humanity. But it also, the same history of the evolution of the mind plays out in the life of each human being on a microcosmic scale. So when the fetus is developing in the womb, as it gestates, that infant child is functioning from Nefesh consciousness. And we know this because after performing a lot of regressive hypnosis on people, taking them back to a time where they remember themselves in their mother's womb, that it becomes very clear that the reasoning faculty doesn't exist at that stage, and that they are existing in an unconscious state. They have a form of consciousness, but it's operating out of Nefesh. There is no self-consciousness. All there is awareness of the womb as a container, and the liquid environment of the room, of the womb, all of these things being associated, of course, with nefesh. Then the moment the infant child is born and takes its first breath, the ruach function, which is idling in potential in the unconscious mind, with that first breath at birth, the ruach kicks into life, and the self-awareness and thinking factor begins to develop. It's interesting to note that the word ruach in Hebrew translates as breath, or the same concept as the Greek pneuma, and that it is the actual breath of life, the first breath that the infant child breathes in at birth, that kicks the ruach into action. The other qualifying factors of ruach awareness are that it represents and is objective consciousness. In other words, its focus, the ruach's focus, is on the outside world, on the objective, concrete, exterior environment. That's what ruach was developed and evolved to become, was an awareness of the nature of external reality. Whereas the nefesh was developed to become an awareness of the nature of the internal reality. So, two poles of a binary: an internal focused awareness, nefesh, and an external focused awareness, which is the ruach. The ruach experiences external reality through the channels of the five senses: smell, taste, touch, sight, feeling. Everything the ruach can know about the actual nature of external reality, he takes in through his five senses. And we can add one extra thing to that, and that is the faculty of thinking itself. Ruach actually has the ability to think about the information that he is absorbing through the five senses. And in this way, he can not only experience the world sensually, but he can conceive of concepts about it. And this thinking faculty is one of the primary functions of ruach. While he is experiencing the outside world, he is thinking. So the language inside of your head, which forms the basis of your ability to think, belongs to ruach. Ruach is intimately connected with the rise of language in the mind, the ability to talk and think and speak and write language, and therefore to calculate and make judgments concerning the nature of reality. And these are the other faculties of ruach. Ruach observes. What he observes, he analyzes and makes judgments concerning those observations, and then he makes plans based on those observations and his judgments of them. In this way, when people talk about, as is commonly referred to these days, that we create our own reality, that is very true. But it doesn't quite happen in the way that they would prefer you to believe. The way we create our own reality, the primary way, is through Ruach's observations of the world. He observes physical reality, the external environment, the objective environment. He analyzes it, makes judgments about it. This is a car, that's a dog, I like that woman over there, I don't like blue cars, and so forth. And then on the basis of those judgments, ruach makes plans about how to deal with life, how to survive in the world. And this really is the purpose of Ruach, to observe, judge, and plan about external reality in order to be able to survive in external reality. And therefore, each individual's ability to survive in the world depends on how well their Ruach is functioning, generally. So, the better you are at observing, the better you are at making judgments and at analyzing the nature of exterior reality, the better you are at making plans based on those observations and judgments, the more successful your life is going to become, generally. Because the way our life turns out is based on our judgments and our plans, I think this is what is going on here, and therefore I am going to do X, Y, and Z things in order to survive in this environment and make the best out of it. Because the way our life evolves, what it turns into, what we become, is based on the observations and judgments our Ruach makes and then the plans that it comes up with, Ruach sees himself as being the guy who is governing everything here, who is making all the choices, who is figuring everything out. For this reason, the Kabbalists and the theoretical alchemists gave Ruach another title, and they called, the Kabbalists called him Melech, and that word translates from Hebrew into king. And we see that term king used all the time in the alchemical tradition. So we have with Nefesh and Ruach a king and queen relationship. And the reason why Ruach is referred to as the king is that he sees himself as the ruler of the little world. In other words, he is the government, he is the dude making the choices, the observations, figuring things out, and deciding how to get stuff in order to survive in the world, and in order to improve his lot in the world. Now, when we remember that Ruach is designed by nature to observe, analyze, and plan about exterior reality, the objective world, what this means is his software, his programming, has no interest in what's going on inside. And what this means is that he has no experience of and no understanding of the higher functions. In fact, he has no evidence at all that they exist. Even for the person who intellectually understands or accepts the concept that the higher functions and the higher self exist and that the higher self governs reality and governs the life of the individual, while Ruach may intellectually accept that idea, the truth of the matter is he won't risk anything based on that intellectualization without proof. Because one of the key features of his judging, analyzing, reasoning, logic-based way of looking at the world is that it's rooted in objective reality. In other words, he needs hard evidence in order to make decisions and plans about the nature of reality. He can't make a choice to do things any other way because that's how he's programmed. So even if he gets very good intellectual evidence of the existence of a higher self and the higher functions, he really will not make plans for survival in physical life based on those ideas without concrete evidence. Because this is the way he thinks and sees the world, His private argument to himself is that there is no higher functions, no higher self, and that it is he himself who is responsible for the individual and the way the individual's life turns out. He is king. That's how he sees himself, and that's what his beliefs are based upon. So under those conditions, we have a state which is popularly referred to as egotism. The Ruach is egotistic. In other words, he is very self-involved and he believes himself to be at the top of the human pyramid. With different individuals, that egotism has varying amounts of intensity, from just being, for example, concerned about personal survival, all the way up to extreme arrogance and tyranny, because the Ruach believes that he is better than anybody else and anything else, and therefore deserves whatever he decides for himself he should have. Now, on the Kabbalistic Tree of Life, we looked at how Nakash is down below the sphere of Malkuth, the physical world. He's below the physical world. We looked at Nefesh and saw how her influence extends from the physical world where she stands up to Yeshod, the sphere of foundation, and the unconscious mind. And that those two spheres are linked by the 32nd path, which the Golden Dawn tradition teaches has the intelligence of Saturn, the dark unconscious mind. So now considering Ruach's situation on the Tree of Life. As I mentioned previously, he grew out of Nefesh, so his feet are in Yeshod on the tree, and therefore in the unconscious. He grew out of Nefesh. He is the womb of the mind and the womb of the rest of the evolving human psyche. And his influence extends from Yeshod all the way up to the sphere of Tifereth. In this way, Ruach's body lays across the 25th path on the Tree of Life, and his head rests in Tifereth, and Tifereth has as an astrological attribution the sun. And of course we know that the sun is the source of light in the objective reality. The sun lights up the objective reality, and therefore it is understandable that Ruach, who views objective reality, whose job it is to observe and judge objective reality, would have his head resting in the sphere of Tifereth, in the sphere of light. Now, when considering Ruach's position on the tree, one of the most important things to understand about his position is that the 25th path, which represents what he is, what his journey is, crosses over another path, the 27th path. In tarot symbolism that is taught by the Golden Dawn tradition, the 25th path is the card of temperance. And there are two versions of that card, but they both basically mean the same thing. Temperance is the ability to juggle, weigh up, and balance the two poles of the binary. In alchemy, those two poles are represented symbolically by the lion and the eagle. And we see in one of the main versions of the Temperance card an angel and a lion and an eagle in juxtaposition towards each other. Some temperate versions of the temperance card have this in a very alchemical form of symbolism, showing that the underlying meaning of which is that the poles of the physical temporal binary are struggling together in order to attain a state of harmony and balance. So in the center of the temperance card we have an angel, and he's got the symbol of the sun on him, so he represents the sphere of Tifereth, the state of illumination. He is like the alchemist. He is the one who is pulling the strings. He's the puppeteer for Nefesh and Ruach, the king and the queen, the lion and the eagle. And over many incarnations, it is his job to bring the individual soul into situations in life in order to cause the Nefesh and Ruach to slowly balance, balance, balance until they merge and become a harmonious unit. And this is what the Temperance card represents symbolically. So the 25th path, beginning at Yeshod and ending in Tifereth, represents that journey, starting off at extreme division, which means separation, opposition, and conflict, and traveling the full length of the 25th path over many lifetimes and ending up eventually in the sphere of the sun, Tifereth, which is represented by a circle with a dot in the middle, which represents unity. So Ruach's journey, the purpose of the Ruach, the reason for having a thinking mind that is analyzing reality and trying to figure out what is going on here, is that it's Ruach's job to steer the direction, the chariot of life, away from division to unity. The 27th path, which crosses over the 25th path, is the tarot card, the Lightning Struck Tower. And at a certain point during many reincarnations, what happens is that enough learning events have built up through lifetimes that the voyaging soul through the cycles of incarnation hits a point where the Ruach suddenly realizes that he isn't the king, that the individual's existence doesn't entirely rely upon him, that there is actually something higher, and that that higher thing creates, sustains, and governs the life of the individual. When that shock of realization dawns on the Ruach, once he actually knows it, not just on an intellectual level, but something happens to Ruach in a particular lifetime where he suddenly realizes, whoa, this is not what I thought was actually going on at all. There actually is something higher going on here, and now I've got to take that into consideration. When this happens, that's at the point where the 25th path crosses the 27th path. So the lightning bolt from out of the blue is the symbol of the higher functions of God, if you like, or whatever you want to call it, the higher functions of the mind causing something to happen in the life of the Ruach, which forces him to realize that the human condition doesn't stop at him, that there is something higher up here. That's the lightning bolt. That's what it represents. The tower itself is a symbol that represents all of the things that Ruach has built up in order to make him think that he's the big smarty pants in the person's life and in human society. So it's science, it's technology, it's all the decisions Ruach makes that turn out productive, at least on a superficial level. All of those things, all of Ruach's achievements, which cause him to then think, yeah, I'm the dude, I'm the one who's running everything here because I'm the only one making decisions and all of that's based on, you know, my judgments of reality. All of that's represented by the tower. So the lightning strikes the tower. In other words, an act occurs on behalf of the higher functions, which suddenly forces Reich to realize that that tower is not actually that big, massive achievement after all. And it crumbles. And we also see in the lightning struck tower card a man and a woman falling away from the tower toward the ground. And that is, of course, the Ruach and the Nefesh falling down off their tower that they have built together, off their belief that the binary forces and their struggle are the ones who are running the whole show, and that's all collapsing. Once that shock, that cathartic realization occurs to the Ruach, from the level where the 27th path is up to the sphere of Tefarif, that part of Ruach's journey is the true symbol of initiation. That's really where real initiation begins, because it's from that point, crossing the 27th path, that the individual thinks, okay, I've got to stop thinking that I'm the one who's all in control here and doing everything, and now I've got to focus on investigating and learning about this other higher part of myself. The end of that journey, this little section of the path on the Tree of Life from the 27th path up to Tefarif, that is the journey of initiation. And when Tefarif is reached, when Ruach actually emerges into the sphere of Tefarif, that is what in the Western tradition we call a state of illumination, where the truth about the nature of reality is fully revealed to the Ruach, to conscious awareness, a state of illumination. And that is the goal of initiation, to have your Ruach merge with that unity consciousness, where it doesn't just see its own little piece of the universe and what it believes about it, but it actually sees the whole picture, which is being governed by that angel in the Temperance card. And that angel is the higher genius, ruling the lower life, juggling like a puppeteer the Nefesh and the Ruach to bring them up to a state of spiritual maturity. So all very important. And of course the title or the special symbolism of this journey for the Ruach is known as the crossroads, for obvious reasons. And of course we see the concept of the crossroads as a really important symbol in the Voodoo tradition, and that it's the place where the hero meets the devil and makes a deal with him. In popular Voodoo tradition, we can see where that comes from. Papa Legba, who is often said in the Voodoo tradition to be their version of Hermes, the hermetic magician, the adept, the teacher, the sage. And all of that happens at the crossroads, where the hero meets with the devil and discovers that there is a God and that there is a higher level to the universe, and that now he has to reorientate his life and overcome the devil and achieve that state of illumination, which is represented by the sun in Tefarif. So this is definitely one of my favorite chunks of Kabbalistic knowledge, where the Part Sufim are concerned, this whole business of the crossroads, what it actually happens, the crisis of humanity. And partly I'm very interested in this because we can see humanity as a whole beginning to actually move towards the 27th path itself, beginning at the very start of that journey, as we enter the age of the apocalypse, the unveiling or the revealing, where all of a sudden the truth about the nature of reality is thrust in our face, and we're forced to realize that there's more going on here than we previously believed. So very fascinating area of study, which I highly recommend to everybody, especially anyone who is on the path of initiation or seeks to be on the path of initiation. And of course, what this means is, as humanity is making that progression across the 27th horizontal, the next stage of human evolution, now that we're at the end of the Ruach area of humanity, is for us to forge a bridge across the abyss that links the lower functions with the higher functions. This is where we leave our lower nature behind, we die to our animal past life, and we rise again on the third day to the light of eternity. So that's more or less where my discussion of the lower part Sufim as individual entities finishes. I'm going to do one more podcast on them, the next podcast, number 10. I'm going to discuss those three lower part Sufim as a triad, how they all function together in the average person's life. I'm going to talk about basically what's going on inside of us, machinery-wise, as incarnate everyday human beings. How do Nefesh and Ruach actually exist, and what do they do in front of us, inside of us, and what role is Nakash playing in that dynamic? That will sort of then cement off all the basic concepts that are necessary to understand about the lower functions, and then we're going to start discussing the higher functions, Neshama, Chia, and Yekida. And I'll look at them one by one and then discuss them as a complete triad. And then finally, we're going to end up this Part Sufim discussion, these podcasts on Part Sufim, by then talking about the relationship between the upper triad and the lower triad, and the connection between them, what it is about us as common human beings that makes that connection exist in the way it does, basically that it's been severed, and then what it is that's required in the average human being to build that bridge across the abyss between the lower and the higher functions in order to complete our journey as human beings. So finally, just to sum up before I close off this video, Ruach is the thinking mind. The word Ruach in Hebrew translates as breath, and therefore air. And we know that the Kabbalists were smart, and they made these attributions because they knew that the Ruach kicked into life when the child's first breath is taken at birth. That the Ruach develops in life to the point of 7 years of age, where it becomes fully self-aware and able to think about the outside world by itself, make its own decisions about what it thinks is going on. And then because of how it observes, how it judges, how it plans about life, because that's its job, I need to survive in this world as a human being, and my Ruach is primarily the one who is making all the observations, judgments, and plans to help me get a job, get food in my mouth, have shelter. Maslow's hierarchy of needs, all those basic things are the focus of the Ruach. And then eventually the pleasure principle of, once all the basic needs of survival are covered, Ruach's next level is to achieve pleasure, like leisurely things, to make life comfortable. And therefore a Ruach's power in the world, in modern society, is judged on the basis of how much leisure items and possessions and conditions the individual human has. In other words, the richer you are and the more toys you have, the smarter your ruach is. And therefore, everybody believes that you are the king of kings because you've got it all worked out. But of course, the smart people, the wise people, the adepts realize that it's all an illusion and it's all going to come crashing down, and that the smart guys, the actual smart guys, are the ones who got past believing that all of the things that Ruach obtains in the world are the things which mark a king, someone who's in control. Because Ruach actually isn't in control, the higher functions are in control. So Ruach thinks he's that voice in your head for the most part, not entirely, but for the most part. That language that he's using to talk to you in your mind, that's one of his functions and his possessions. Language is intimately connected with Ruach. It's why in ancient Egyptian mythology, Thoth, the god who taught humanity science and magic and language and civilization, is intimately associated with the Ruach and the thinking function. He is the god of the rational mind, of magic, science, and language. They're all connected. And that's self-evident. Okay, so that was take 3 or 4, I think. And it's been, 3 weeks or 4 weeks now since my last video. So here's hoping that all of this recorded properly and the green screen behind me works, because that's what it's really all about. It's enough light for the green screen without casting shadows on it. And thanks again for tuning in, for watching till the end. And I hope I see you in the next podcast.